Coins Flory Models Q&A. Here we are on Tuesday the 8th of March 2016. So you've got me for the next hour or so, and I'll go through as many questions as I possibly can that you've asked in the forum. Remember, if you want to get any questions direct to me, always do it through the forum and through the Ask Phil. And don't forget, we also got Ask Steve and we've got Ask Hans as well. So if you want to ask them any questions whatsoever, direct, have a word with them and we'll sort it all out. Me today, as I said, lots of catching up. I've got various things going out and everything else like that. Terminator is supposed to be a free for view. I know a lot of you said, did you realise it's out everywhere? Yes, obviously, it's just the last bit of it. And obviously, it gives non-members a bit of an insight what we do. And obviously, for the wash and everything else like that. So that is supposed to be up there. And then hopefully tomorrow, now all the bits are in for the actual Halifax, we can crack on with that one. I'm going to be starting on that this week and making our way through. And then on Monday, hopefully, well, you will do, you get the first part. Like this little guy up and everything else like that. And having looked at the decals and all the various bits and pieces on there, actually, I think it's going to be a good one. Really looking forward to doing that paint scheme. Got to sort out the colours for it yet, but that's something obviously we'll talk about on a different show. So, needless to say, on we go. So, first question up. We're going on from last week, so these are the ones that have sort of the carryover, if you like, that have happened since the 1st of March. Okay, Brett says, I'm now the proud owner of an Infinity CR Plus Evolution airbrush. For both daily use, I'm very happy with how it sprays, the quality, the atomization, the trigger action, and ease of cleaning. A few rinses and a blowout, the cleaner, and it's done the trick. My question is, how often do your airbrush to clean out the nozzle separately? Do a full strip down. Sorry, do you do a full strip down? Can't read today. Right. Well, for me, there's a classic example to it. And it's usually when the trigger jams. So actually, it hasn't, amazingly. Normally, every now and again, the only thing with all airbrushes is you clean them out, they're clean as a whistle. If you're like me and leave the needle in, what can happen is you get up to it, and we've all got it, and the needle is jammed, okay? So when you go to pull back, nothing happens. It's solid, okay? Easiest way is just put a couple of drops of thinners down in there, acrylic thinners, X20A in my case, okay, and then what I'll do is I'll pull it back, it slightly slides on the needle, and then I'll just whip the back off like this, undo the collet, it goes forward with the mechanism, okay, on the spring, and then I'll do it again a couple of times, and then it breaks the seal. What it is, the triple seals on these, because obviously it's a CR Plus versions, they actually grab the needle, okay? And sometimes you get a little bit of paint in there and everything else. So what I highly recommend is grab it, pull the needle out, and the classic example is there, and when you feel along, you'll see where those triple seals are. And I've got them here, and you've got a little bit of paint there. And then just literally grab yourself a bit of tissue, okay? And you just give it a whiz in there with some thinners on and all the rest of it. It comes off, it'll be nice and clean, and you'll notice when you put it in, you'll get no sort of big crusty thing. You're not pushing through anything crusty. It should just slide in there, no problem at all. Okay, and then you pop the back on and you'll be finding that you're good to go. Okay, to be honest, this one had it yesterday and again is now absolutely fine. Okay, that's normally when I'll think about, well, look, if it's crusty in there, chances are it needs a bit of a clean out. So what I'll do, I'll do a simple strip clean. So obviously we'll whip the needle out, we'll take the front off, we'll reamer out the inside. You've seen me do it loads of time before, there's videos up on it and everything else like that. Colour cup off and we'll just give it a clean through and we'll be good to go like that. What I'll also do is put the needle through backwards a couple of times so it just goes in that way all the way around. So in from the back, blunt end first, push through and you might get some bits on the end. That just cleans out those seals. Okay, so those seals, especially if it's triplicate, sometimes you get bits between them, it should then clean them out and you'll be good to go. Blow it all the way through, make sure you're nice and clean, and do it for your next spray job. But obviously it depends. With me, a lot of people say they have trouble with it, jams and stuff like that. Always take the needle out. If you're going to be not spraying for perhaps a week, 2 weeks, maybe a month, it's well worth taking the needle out. Now, I know a lot of people will say, yeah, but what about the seals? I don't think they're a problem. They'll just relax, and if anything, it'll give you a better seal when it comes in. But if you leave them in there, what can happen is they will just weld onto the needle. And then when you do push it through, they'll slightly tear, especially if they're the old rubber type. Teflon ones, obviously not so much, but that's what I would highly recommend. But as for cleaning out, if you're using it all the time and it's always soft and it's blowing through and you have no problem with it, really there's no point totally taking it apart and stripping it down. As soon as you get a problem, I believe in it. But a couple of things I will do. If it's going to be a clear coat and using lacquers, it will get a full strip down clean before I do that, because you only need a small amount of paint somewhere in there and it goes through. How many times have you cleaned out your airbrush and you do that thing and it blows and then hardly anything, you get little tiny spits of paint at the end of it? That can contaminate, especially if you're spraying white, things like that. So it is well worth giving down a strip down for that. But usually, as soon as it starts to spit, it's not running right, I will then just strip it and away we go and just use it like that. But I don't think there's no rule. I don't think you should be doing it like once a month or once every 6 months. Just do it as and when it needs it. Let's face it, they're easy to take apart. You don't need any tools and it's just a straightforward job. Okay, so what is the best way to thin Vallejo model colour for spraying? Obviously, they've got their own thinners. The Vallejo thinners I love. To be honest, I haven't got any at the moment. I'm out of it. But usually I have. As you know, I use it as much as I use Tamiya X20A. The only difference I find between the two, the Tamiya X20A is a little bit more aggressive when it comes to like putting down decals. You know, I use it for that method. But generally, there's no real difference between it. If it will thin with Tamiya X20A, it'll thin with the Vallejo one. And their stuff is great. And vice versa. So if I was going to be thinning, Mr. Vallejo model colour, which are the white top ones, which are these, which I must admit, I am going to get a load in and do a couple of things with them. I want to play with them a little bit more. This is the sky grey, which actually I got in for a Draken, which is probably 15 years ago now, maybe even more, and everything else like that. But again, it's like toothpaste, very thick. It's very nice because it doesn't dry very quickly. So if you're in a hot climate, things like that, you could use these. But value for money, I think these are one of the best value paints out there because it thins and thins and thins. So you'd be thinning this roughly 75%. That's what I would recommend. And that will be much like Model Air, obviously the pre-thin version. You can just tell by the weight of it. It's a heavier duty paint and all the rest of it. And I do like it. It does seem to work very, very well. But as you say, in advances with modern paints and things like that, it's almost got left behind, I think. Figure painters absolutely love this stuff, and I can understand why. But from a spraying point of view, I think it's very much overlooked. And I would like to do a few things with it, because every time I've used it, it works a treat. I have no problems with it. It's just that it's so much easier with Model Air because the colours as well, they're named for it. You just follow them along, especially in recent years when they've come out with like the Israeli Defence Force aircraft colours and things like that. So easy and straightforward to go. Where are these? Sometimes the names don't match up to actually what it is and things like that. So, but yeah, no problem with that one. Just go in with X20A or, you know, their own thinners and you'll be good to go. Okay, so that was Rob. Okay. Gintaris, sorry, horrible with names, need Sid for this. Hello Phil, now everybody is talking about the new Mr. Paint. Do you have any plans for doing a review on these? This is something I've been asked probably about 50 times, and that's not an exaggeration. I've had everybody say to me, when are you going to do it, when are you going to get it? I have a real problem with their stuff. Two things, actually, I have problems with. One is the way that they call it an acrylic lacquer-based paint. Well, the pigment is acrylic. I grant you, all pigments are going to be acrylic by their nature of what they are. But it's the carrier being a lacquer-based, and then we're back into a hot product, okay? And as you know, I'm trying to move away as much as I possibly can to it, and I have got rid of a lot of my lacquer paints. It's very rare I'll use self-leveling thinners as well, because obviously that's lacquer based, even though it gives an amazing finish and I love it and it's great. If it was down to me, I would just be using the Guns lacquer based paints, because they are the finest paints I still believe out there. They are beautiful. And then if you put them in conjunction with the self-leveling thinner, they are absolutely amazing. So I would highly recommend going down that route. As for these paints, a couple of things that there is a problem with it. Not only is the smell, and it's a hot product and all the rest of it, which I don't like, but also it's getting hold of them. They're not readily available, and the price of them. Now, I know the guys are going to turn around now and say, oh, but it's amazing, it covers and it's beautiful and everything else like that. I'm sure they are, and I have no problem with it. It's just from my point of view, I'm doing things now for you guys. So I would only be doing it for you because I certainly wouldn't use it day to day, because it's not the type of product I like to use. I'm sure it sprays beautifully. I'm sure it's a fantastic color match and all those things go with it. And I probably will do an on test just to demonstrate. But for me, day to day work, I'm trying to avoid those types of products because, you know, I can't sit here in a mask all day long and all the rest of it and doing it day in day with lacquers and horrible hot products. Over the years, I've gently whittled myself away. Came off of enamels in the late 90s, And then we're into acrylics only, and then you get obviously alkalads and stuff like that come along, so you sort of use those, but it basically sprays and smells and everything like a like an alkalad. So, you know, from the point of view of a good system to get rid of the fumes and that, yes, check, we've got it. It's just one of those things day to day. It's just a bit, but I will get them in, no doubt, and we will do a test. As I say, I've got that flanker down there. I thought about getting them in for doing that, the actual sea flanker and everything else, because I thought it might be quite a nice touch to do it with that one, but as a one-off. But as I say, day to day, it's not something that I would be jumping into. Okay, so Gareth says, hi Phil, I've had a thought that maybe you could add a new section. Videos depicting the different techniques that can be achieved with all your pigments, unless you've already done it. Making mud, wet mud, rust. I know you showed a lot of streaking on the Terminator, but is there anything else that can be done with them? Yeah, that's not pig. Well, I don't know, unless you're getting confused with the wash. The wash is clay-based. The pigment is pigment, as you can imagine. Trust me, there is pigment in the clay wash, obviously, but it's clay, big white blocks of the stuff, okay? And that's what makes this stuff cling and hold on and lock in and everything else like that. Pigment is dusty and powdery, and it just goes over. It's the clay that's doing all the work, so that's clay in there. If you wanted to see more on that type of thing, then obviously I intend to do a lot more of that in the future, because there it is, the techniques you can do in there. That's why we did this one as a free one as well, to show about chipping with this stuff, because you can actually use it as a chipping medium as well, which is something I've done for years and years and years, but it's very hard to sort of show it. This one I had an opportunity to show it, so that's why we've done it as a free to watch video on it. But certainly I can do more of those ones, that's not a problem. If you are talking pigments, best one to have a look at is the Sherman build. We did the EZ8 Sherman. To be honest, I used pigments solely through that. We used them wet, dry, with thinners, with enamel washes. We dry brushed them, we painted them on, we used them as mud. You name it, we did it to that Sherman. So that has got everything about pigments on that one. So if you want to have a look at that one, by all means do it. I'm thinking about dragging it back out of the depths and re-editing it to just show the pigments and then locking them in a section of its own. So if I ever get time to do these things, I will certainly get it done for you. Okay, Jeff says, hi Phil, what is the latest thinking of gloss clear coating? Is Future still the way to go? I'm looking for another option. I still use Future in all my builds to protect the paint and the surface for deckling. Once that is done, then I flatten it back with Model Master acrylic flat base. What is the latest and greatest for everyday gloss coating? P.S. I've noticed I've now been a member for nearly 8 years. Thank you for creating such great place and content. No problem, Jeff. Yes, you are. Crikey, you're almost it. We've been going 9 years now doing this, so yeah, that's it. One more and you get a medal. Right, gloss coating. Yes, Future was always the way to go, purely because it was cheap. It was straight from the bottle, you just sprayed it down, job done, and away you went. Nowadays, because of modern ways of doing things and the price of Future's gone up, it's not as important as it used to be. I still maintain if you wanted to, you could knock up some acrylic resin is a good one that I tend to use, and that will give you that same effect for the same money, and you're guaranteed no yellowing, because their stuff is a proper one, and the yellow pigment, which is what makes things yellow, is microscopic in their one, whereas Future, it will turn yellow over time. So there is that point of view to it. Is it the latest or greatest? It is still a great product. It is still a clear gloss coat. It is easy to use. Straighten your airbrush, spray it down. So like you, I use it for protecting paintwork before I decal and things like that. I don't tend to use it for anything else now. I don't use it certainly for gloss work and all the rest of it. If you're talking gloss work, if you want gloss, and we're talking things like we did on the Hawk, the bike, things like that, then obviously I would highly recommend going down either the lacquer coat, okay, a clear lacquer, which we know is a hot product and all the rest of it, and I'm just saying I don't like them, but there's something about it, you can't beat it, okay? It is probably the way to go. So if you want to see about that, have a look about the Ducati, because that shows all about doing it, two-pack paint, stuff like that. So if you want to do gloss work, that is definitely what I would highly recommend doing it. If you're talking protecting-wise, then still go for Future. It's still great to do it. But I have got somewhere, it'll be down there somewhere, a bottle knocked up, ready to go, of acrylic resin, which is, I imagine we've got one down here. There we go. It's one of these. This is just the acrylic resin in white. I have got this out for a reason. Okay, this here, how well you can see it, I haven't got the top can going today, but you see this is yellowed, and this is what we're on about. All things will yellow. This is a really old bottle that I found, which I've probably had now for, I don't know, probably about 5 or 6 years. And there we go. This isn't in direct sunlight. This is just in the studio. Now, we know we've got these bloody great LED light banks and the sun, as we call it, up there, the normal one as well, and everything else. But it just goes to show how quickly things can go awry. And this is what I'm saying about gloss coats. Make sure that they've actually got an anti-yellowing thing in there. It's not going to stop it, because yellowing is one of those things. The yellow pigment is so strong in nature, it finds its way into anywhere, and that's why things go yellow. But if you're going to go down the lacquer route, you shouldn't get it at all, because it's specifically designed to anti-ultraviolet light and all the rest of it, so it shouldn't turn. Acrylic tends to do it though, and that's the problem with it. Okay, so Paul says, talking of that, two questions. I've just watched your review on the FW190. I'm wondering about your decision, to use the color photo etch. Aren't you going to remove all that lovely detail from the resin cockpit? Yeah, but you, as I say, it's a panel set and all the rest of it. So if you wanted to, you could go in and just redo the instrument panels and things like that, or you can put it on. It's personal choice. It's just that for the writing and stuff like that around it, I am a klutz. That's the problem with that one. It's very hard for me to get in there and get all that detailing and all the rest of it, and it's quicker. So you could whip off that, pop that down. We've got spare bezels and the various bits and pieces to give it the depth if we wanted to, and all things like that, and do it that way. We used it quite successfully on the 124th with the the Hawker Typhoon. It worked fantastic, and I love the effect it got, and it got a better effect than that. I treat the resin cockpit as you've got all of that other stuff. This is just going to be the panels, okay? And if you remember, when we actually did the Typhoon, we didn't do the side panels. We deckled those. We just used it for the forward instrument panel. I might do the same as well, because as I said, I find it, having the gauges and the various bits and pieces, you just get a better quality and a better look to it if you're doing it that way. And if you weather it in, dry brush it in, it will blend in beautifully, and it will go as an enhancement to the rest of the detail in the resin cockpit. So that would be my thing to that. Second question, I recently tried to clear lacquer over the canopy, and it's eaten into the plastic and fogged the canopy. Now, we've got a picture down here as well. What is the difference to the way you used it on the Hawk and the way you did it on your IB6 and the bike? Right, well, you've got a picture there of it. So it's the old Simon Eyes or Simon Is clear lacquer cellulose. The only thing I can think of is that it hasn't eaten in. It's because when you sprayed it down, you put it down too light. Now, I've got my Hawk here, which is a bit dusty. But this is our glossed one that we did all that work to, is what we were talking about. And this is that clear canopy, which, to be honest, was absolutely awful. It was covered in dust, it had scratches on it, and all those things to it. And mine, as you can see, is still beautifully clear. What I reckon it is that it's not eating it in. When you've put down the coat, you've gone in a little bit too light, so it's almost, like a flat effect onto it. And it's etched in and dried, and then the subsequent coats over the top haven't melted into itself. When you're coming in and doing clear parts like this, and I was coming in with that one, when I did it, it's a positive thing. When you're doing any type of gloss work, you don't want to be messing around with, when you're doing it, you're going to go in, you're going to be positive, and you're going to blast it down. Okay, so you want a thick, wet stripe right across it. Okay, because I don't think that's eaten as such, because it shouldn't eat. It's just a lacquer product. The only thing you could do, just to make sure, is dip it in clear first and then lacquer it afterwards. And then that way, that will prevent anything. But to be honest, I didn't mask this guy. When I did that re-lacquering job on this, just to see, I went straight over it just like that. Okay, and the canopy and everything else is still clear, and we are all good to go. Excuse all the things. And to be honest, we had real problems with this, because I had lumps and bumps and nasties and everything else. But as you can see, it is still, catch him in the light, ding, 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 absolutely fantastic. It came out really, really nice. But I think that's what it is. If you're, with all glossing work, if you take that approach of being a bit gentle with it and slow, it gets dry patches each side. As soon as those dry patches dry, they're rough and you've got to build over that. When you're doing type of gloss work like we did with this one, to be honest, I started on a wingtip and I did the entire lot in one. So when we were coming across with this one, you know, we actually used this airbrush. We just came in and it was a case of, right, we're doing it at the top. So we went across, so it's soaking wet all the way through. We came down on here and then literally across, all in one. To be honest, I had a pole up its backside. Okay, right the way across in one. So we did that entire top. I came down here, we got the hairdryer out, and then I just kept on moving it, rotating it, because you know it's all going to start to run and go south to take care of it. Once we had done that and we were happy that it was going off, we then did the underside in exactly the same fashion. So I had a pole and had hold of it like this. We just started on this wing and we worked our way over. Okay, and I just came up slightly on this edge, but really thick, because we still had a little dry area in the middle. So once I'd done it all, I redid the sides, the actual fuselage again, because again, the edges, it's dry and it gives a little bit of a texture to it. So I wanted to avoid that, and that's what we did with that one. So again, that one we did as a normal gloss one in the first days, worked really well, but we improved it by using the automotive lacquer because that works so much better. And also the other thing as well, that is a one pack lacquer, i.e. it's a one shot. The way I used a two pack lacquer, so it's actually a lacquer and an activator. Now it won't go off without the activator either. So by doing what I did, and that was putting a smaller amount of activator in it, it took forever for it to go off. So it gives it time to self level and, you know, get down and everything else like that. And that's what I learned about the scale effect, because if you blast it on, it's just too thick and too heavy. So to give it time to work and to set itself and level itself out, I only used about a third, instead of it like being a 50-50 mix, I think it's 2-to-1 ratio. I was doing it so it was basically a sort of, you know, two clear lacquer to one activator. So it just gave it more time. And I'm saying that to make it totally go off, and I mean handleable like that is now, it probably took about a week. Okay, whereas normally it takes 20 minutes. Okay, and you'd be good to go. And because it's a chemical reaction of the lacquer, that is the difference with it. I haven't tried that one, so I wouldn't know. That is my thing to it. But if you wanted to protect your clear stuff, it might be worth dipping them in future and acrylic, because that will stop anything etching into it like that's happened there. But it could be the fact that we're saying you was a little bit too polite with it, and instead of it eating it in, it's frosted it, but then the other stuff's gone on top and it's not eating in and self-leveling. When we did that, it was almost dripping. I'm amazed we didn't get any runs, but that's because it's two pack as well. It's thicker. Okay, because as soon as it's in, it's activating and it starts to harden and go off. So that's why you don't get any runs with it. And that's why I like it. So to be honest, this guy's going to get a clear coat of it as well. I'm going to try and weather it as well. So I'm not sure exactly how much lacquering it's going to get. But I'm thinking to seal those decals down and the paintwork and make it nice, I might lacquer it. Then we come in. I'm not saying I am, because I want to weather it. Because as I said, lots been said recently, and I was talking to a lot of people who have said to me, why is it all models of airliners all look like diecast? Because they don't have weathering. Yet you look at any aircraft, and I have to agree, they're filthy. Okay, but what airliner guys never seem to do it. So they would like to see me weather it. So that's why I intend to do a little bit of weathering on it, just to see exactly what we get, just before we move on to the other bits and pieces with it. But it would be nice to put a lacquer down on it, because I do like working with a lacquer now. Okay, so that was Paul. So Chris says, hi Phil, question about modelling lighting. While nav lights, etc. Are well catered for, no one seems to have a good modern slime lights. Have you done them? If you know, how would you tackle them? Okay, you can buy the tape. Slime line is what it is in Craftwise as well. It's an electrical voltage going through this tape stuff and it makes it glow. That's all it is. It's the same thing. You can buy it, I think, in the bluey green color. You can definitely do a green, you can do a yellow and a white. Okay, and it's basically a tape and you can cut it to what sizes you want, and that's it. And that's how the slime lines work in reality. It's just a voltage going through it. Now, I've seen guys use it on the back of Millennium Falcons. That's how I know this stuff works. And it looks absolutely fantastic. And you can even put a pulse through it as well. It makes it shimmer. Everything else. The thing is, I don't know is how small you can make it, because normally the tape has to be a certain size, I think, to regulate its voltage and all the rest of it. It's tiny. I don't think either you might burn it out or anything else, because normally it's like, you know, 5 volt and it's a tape yay wide, you know, and anything else like that, or like a ruler. I've seen it done on the bigger Millennium Falcons and it's about this size, and obviously it curves round and it looks stunning. Okay, it really does look nice. Now, I'm not sure if you was to do a slime line on an aircraft, obviously you're just talking, even on 32nd, you're only going to be talking 2 centimetres by probably 1/4 of a centimetre in width and all the rest of it. 48th and 72nd, that's going to be very, very small. You can buy Dayglow paint. You know, that's the other way to do it. Revel, I think, used to do that glowing ghosty paint. It was like a ghost green. I think they did it like a blue as well. So you can get those. But actually, for making lights that light up, you can do it that way. Or my other chosen way would be to do it is to actually get like a very thin piece of styrene sheet, and we're talking the very thin stuff. So, very thin stuff somewhere. Sorry. I had some, I haven't got now, unless I've got some in here. Okay. Now this here is 0.35 millimeters or 1/5 styrene sheet. And as you can see, it is literally like paper. And the thing is, I've got my phone today. If you was to put light behind this, it will naturally glow. So actually what you could do is put an LED behind it, okay, and just paint this that slimy green. And when you turn it on, it will go through. But I don't know how well you can probably see. You can actually see through the actual, I can see the writing. In fact, hey, look, the touch still works through it. Okay, but there we go. So that shows how you do it. And as I say, that is 0.3 mil. Okay, we've gone the other way now. And you can do it that way. All right, so that would probably be the easiest way, because that voltage thing is, I'm not sure if you can do it, but I would cut this down, paint it, cut it, put it on, and then have an LED behind it. So the LED, you turn it on, it projects onto this, okay, and then that will give you your slime light and do it that way. The thing is, you want the LED to be positioned back. Very much like how we did the Star Destroyer, you don't want the LEDs right up to the hole, because otherwise you get like a pierce point, and then around it is like not very much at all. But if you set it back, you get the focus then of the LED is the same width as what you need. The trouble with that is, though, if you're going to start putting it into like tails of aircraft, because let's face it, that's where they have it. Even on, we've got it over there, the slime lines for the actual Typhoon. So it might just grab him, seeing as he's right here. So for those who are thinking, what the hell is he on about? We're talking these stripes here. Okay, we've got them on the tail here, okay, and everything else like that. So it's this striping here. And even on 32nd scale like we've got here, it's quite hard. But to get a light up in here is going to be an absolute nightmare, okay? So, as again, I think is a good reason why people haven't done it, because wiring it up and getting power into here would be an absolute nightmare. Things like in here, I would just have an LED set in the middle, probably crossing each other, and then have it just set in. Cut through the plastic, okay, completely. So you take a channel that width in there, then I'd have this stuck over the hole. Because to be honest, that's all it is. It's like that stuff stuck on in reality, okay, and just have it put over it like that, all right? So that would be my recommendation way of doing it, just like that. Put that down there. Okay, right, okay. Johanna says, hi Phil, I've tried your washes on 2 projects and like them very much, but I have some questions. One, is it necessary to protect the paint with a varnish before you use the clay wash? If you're not used to using it, then yes, definitely. The thing is, the clay wash, it won't harm anything, it's not going to do anything, it's not going to eat into your paint or all those things like that, but the water will. So if you're using acrylic, like we did on this one, we spoke about it a lot with that particular build and showed it a lot, the standalone videos for that if you haven't seen it, okay, and it's free to watch as well, it will sort of soak into the paint and it will bubble it, okay. Now if you're a bit sort of heavy-handed and start rubbing it with brushes and that, you could peel the paint off and literally strip the paint off, but it's the water that's doing it, it's not the clay as such or anything else, okay. But again, like I showed on that, just leave it, go away, it'll dry back and you'll be absolutely fine with no problem at all with it. But to stop all of that, if you was to give it a gloss coat or a satin or a flat coat, just to give an extra layer that the water's got to get through, and that's what we're talking about here, it's all layers. With that, it's model air, it's quite thin, it's quite fragile paint as we know, and we quite heavily went in and abused and sprayed it and all the rest of it. So if you're not used to using it and you're not aware of what it can do and its limitations and things like that, then I definitely give it a satin finish. If you're going to do wing armor and stuff like that, you could obviously go with flat. We used a flat coat all over that, all right, before we came in with all the weather in, because we wanted it to grip. If you're not used to it, do a gloss or a satin, and then when you're used to it, then you can use flat. Okay, how long does it take to, for the clay need to dry before you can put another color of wash on top of the model without destroying the previous work? As soon as it's dry, so usually 10 minutes, 20 minutes, but the usual thing with the clay wash, don't forget, you can leave it on for weeks and come back at a later date. If I wanted to at any point, because you know, you could go in there and go over this, although it's had a flat coat over the top so we could do the chipping work with it, you could go in and literally give it another coat right the way now and it'll be absolutely fine and change the color of it. And to be honest, I did that a little with that, because when we came in with the grime, I found it too, I don't know, I lost the detail, so I went back over it with the black again, just some little areas around the bolt heads and things like that, the lower skirt, stuff like that, because it was too light a dirt for me, so I wanted to get in there and do it, so we went straight over the top with the black again, but literally as soon as it's dry. So you could speed it up with a hairdryer or with just an airbrush or just blowing air on it, and as soon as it's dry, so literally 10, 15, 20 minutes and it'd be good to go, or just leave it overnight and come back to it the next day. Do you have to protect the clay wash after you finish the item? No, it's as hard as nails. It doesn't rub off. That's the whole point. The clay is proper clay. It's not dusty. It doesn't go chalky. It's not like pastels and stuff like that, where as soon as it's dry, it goes and it starts to rub off. So for instance, this here, all down here, you can come along and there's nothing coming off of this at all. It's absolutely fine, handleable, it's no problem, and I do handle my models, as you know, a hell of a lot, and all the rest of it, and we just have no problem with it, you know, and it just doesn't come off. What you want to watch though, if you've got greasy hands, hot hands, sweaty hands, wet hands, then yes, because if you touch it, you're going to rehydrate the clay and then it's going to go. So protect that. You could just chuck a coat of whatever you like over the top of it. But the wash, I find, is a little bit like using metallizers and stuff like that. It has its own look. Okay, it has its own sort of, you know, sheen, and it's very realistic. It doesn't dry, as we were saying, like a chalky or anything else like that. It dries like dirt does, okay? So it gives it that look. So the trouble is, if you overcoat it, you might lose that sort of natural grime and luster that we've made doing this one. Okay, so Valentino says, or Val says, oh god, no, it's doing funny things to me. Go away. There we go. Hi Phil, I know you're going over old ground here, but I'm sorry, but if it's been answered before, but I'm the proud new owner of a bottle of Steinel Res. I'm now looking at the definitive answer to the needle size and thinning question. Do you have to thin it? If so, what with? And a 0.2 needle in my Evo, okay, or would you recommend a 0.4 purchase? Okay, when it's brand new, this stuff, it's very, very wet. Okay, like you can hear it in there. Over time though, it thickens up. Now, as we know, we've gone over this before, as you were saying, we've put a bolt in here, or a nut in here, an M5 nut, just rattling around, stainless steel, marine grade, so it's not going to rust or anything else. Okay, what tends to happen is it thickens up. When it's new, it went straight through my 0.2 beautifully, and to be honest, with no problem at all. And a lot of people said, you can't do that. It doesn't work. It needs a 0.4 or 0.5 ideally. Well, I put it through a 0.2, no problem. But when I came to do it the second time, this bottle had obviously then been a month or so old. It had been opened. I think it got a little bit thicker. It began to spit when I was trying to spray it through my 0.2. So at that point, to be honest, I've got here, which is now become my primer airbrush, is my older Evo. Okay, so this is my Evo, and this has got a 0.4 in it, because to be honest, this was a 2-in-1 airbrush. So it came with the 0.2 and it came with the 0.4. Never used the 0.4. So I loaded this one up, we changed the nozzle to a 0.4. We've got the 0.4 needle in there now, and I use it for priming, and we've used it on this guy down here because it's had now 3 or 4 coats of primer and various things like that. So from that point of view, I think it is worth having a bigger airbrush. Now, I've heard people have horror stories with this stuff, using it with a 0.35 with eye-waters. Apparently, the eye-water airbrush doesn't like this thing in anything smaller than a 0.4, 0.5 ideally, but it tends to struggle a lot. Now, I can't vouch for that because I haven't got one. Well, I have. I've got two over there, but I haven't tried them through it. But I would highly recommend a 0.4. You could go 0.6 because that's the options with Harder and Steam, but you've got 0.6, 0.4, 0.2, and 0.15, which is too small. Okay, so yes, you could do it that way. As for thinning it, I used IPA. Now, okay, shoot me, we've had this in the forum. Somebody actually posted up in there that it goes thick and gummed up and everything else. It didn't with mine. We spoke about it. I've got 99% isopropyl alcohol or rubbing alcohol. Apparently, if you use a lesser one, it tends to thicken up, all right? But we did try it on the live test with various other things, and it seemed to work. It didn't thicken up. We couldn't actually get it to thicken up when we put lacquer thinners through it and things like that. It seemed to work okay. I think it's just the alcohol count and things like that. But generally, you shouldn't really need to thin it. That's the thing is, I think I thinned this one purely because it just got thick and gummed up and everything else. Didn't put the lid on properly. My only other high recommendation is do not use the squirter. There's a good reason for that. I can, if you'll see it, but you might notice, but we got crud and nasties all over the edges of these. If you're squirting it, some of this gump, shall we say, for want of a better word, falls in, okay? And if that gets into your airbrush, sayonara, because it really doesn't like it. And once it's in there, it's incredibly hard to get out. You need to get a reamer in there and dig it out because it doesn't melt, all right, and everything else like that. So I'd highly recommend shaking, unscrew the cap, pour it, clean your cap off. All right, I don't, okay, but I know a lot of people do, and put it back together and you'll be good to go with that one. Okay, so Mark says, hi Phil, I'm a new subscriber and loving the site. I've learned so much already after watching some of your tutorials and video builds. My modeling is showing results already, thank you. I have a question about airbrushes. I recently purchased an Evolution 2-in-1, not the CR, which is exactly the same as this one then, although take note it's at the end. And it's much better than my old Neo. It replaces. It replaced. So much so that I'm already contemplating getting another. So I'm not continuously changing the nozzle nozzles for different tasks, etc. My question is the Infinity that much better to the Evolution in terms of performance to justify an extra £50? Or would another Evolution do the job just as good? Thanks in advance. Keep up the great work. Cheers, Mark. Okay, Mark. It's one of those dilemmas because there isn't that much difference in performance. In fact, there is no difference in performance between the Infinity. Where are they? Here. Okay. And the Evolution. The big thing you have to remember, this silver bit at the front is exactly the same as this bit of silver front here. The nozzles are the same and everything else is the same. Okay, that's great about these because you can interchange them, and trust me, they do get swapped around a lot. All right, the difference is this bit at the back. Okay, you can lock the trigger, okay, which is actually more handy than you would think. If you're just getting into airbrushing at the moment, don't worry about it, but later on in life it comes quite handy. Point of fact, when we did the MIG, where's the MIG these days? Always over there. When we did the MIG and we're using the Vallejo acrylic metal colours, it has a problem. If you flood it, it doesn't like it. So what I did was lock the trigger. So every pull I had would only do X amount, and I gave me a beautiful thing. That way it took out me being like thunder fingers, overdoing the trigger and ending up putting too much paint down, flooding it and getting a gritty effect. So from that point of view, it is very handy. Okay, so you could do that. The other thing as well is getting to the needle and cleaning it out and all those bits and pieces is a lot easier with this guy because you can actually retract the needle when it's not locked just by pulling it here. Okay, so that is quite a handy thing. For instance, if you do have a jam trigger, all I do is I literally pull it a bit, okay, and then it slides back and holds, undo the chuck, okay, which I can do just like that. It flicks forward, I do it back up and pull. Trust me, it's quicker to do it than say it. This one, I have to take the back end off, okay? Little things. The other thing as well this one's got is a tensioner on here. So it's this little dial, and the more it squeezes in, so if you go all the way right, the way forward, all the way in, it makes the trigger more thicker, Okay, the only way to describe it is a thicker. So when you pull it, it's more sluggish, okay, and all the rest of it. Yet if you have it unscrewed all the way back, it takes a little bit of spring out of the trigger, if you like. You're just slacking off the actual pulling back, and it makes this really soft and floppy, okay? Steady at the back. But it's personal choice. It's one of those things where it's a bit of a gimmick, and if I'm honest, both of these are more for your artists. If you're spraying using a 0.15 needle, which let's face it, it seems like a hair, with ink, I'm sure the artists doing that, they need these controls. Okay, for what we tend to do, probably not so. Okay, but that is what you're paying for. That extra bit is this back here. So it's not really worth it, but it's damn handy. If you have got that spare 50 quid, go and get one, okay? The other difference is as well, the CR Plus, and that's the version you're gonna go with, has the triple filter system in it, triple seals, it's triple coated, it doesn't work. They say that apparently that the insides are supposed to not go funny colors now. Rubbish, mine have all done it, okay? And so from that point of view, it's just the same. But there you go. It's just one of those things. I think the little extras you don't use day to day, but when you do, they're quite handy to have. So if you could afford it, I would say go for it. But if you can't, don't bother, because it really isn't that much of a difference. Okay. It's just that if you're stepping up from something like a Neo to one of these, it's probably going to be overkill, because all these functions you're not going to really use. But now you've gone to an Evo and you're aware that, okay, it feels better and all the rest of it, this thing's even better, because when you're using this one, it feels, but this one just has that little bit more control. It's a little bit more finer, gives a lot more nicer thing. The other thing as well is with this one, you get the pinch clean needle on the end, which is really handy, and you're also getting there this guy, which is a distance guide for doing lines. But I use it for primer, because you don't get the bubbles. Sometimes you get little balls on the end when you're flooding and painting fast. You don't get it, so I use that for the primer, so that way it doesn't get any buildup on the end. So no buildup, no spitting, easy to use and clean and all the rest of it, just like that. So there we go, Mark, hope that helps. Okay, Kevin says, still can't find where the contestants' winners are for the mentions for the posts, so you could please fill me in. Thank you, Kevin. Didn't we? I thought we mentioned it last week. Right, I'll get back and check. I thought we already did. Didn't I mention it on our live show? I thought we did on that one. So, right, I'll look into that. Hi, Phil. Can't wait for the FW190. Can you tell me where I can put... can you tell me how to put decals on rubber tyres so they don't dry and come off? Weld the buggers on. Literally, you want to use a very hot setter to get them to go on, okay? Now, you could also use things like X20A, because that really gets them to go in, but that's what you're trying to do. You're trying to make these little buggers melt literally down onto it, because the trouble with the rubber ones, and that's the trouble with rubber tires in general, they've got that little bit of flex, and obviously they're quite porous. So I found when I've done bikes and the various bits and pieces and the car tires and stuff like that, that if you go in there, to go in there hot and heavy with a good one. So Microsole, but to be honest, which is the red one, Micro Set and Sole, isn't any good for it. I usually go in. And the other way, of course, is to use extra thin. Be careful, because once it goes in, it is literally a one trip. So if you knock it, it will melt it, it will go everywhere. But you do one quick pass and then leave it, and it will literally melt its way onto it. But just be careful with it. If you've never done it before, test it before you do it, because it literally is one of those things. If you're too slow putting it down and you drag it, it will then drag the pigment and it just looks like blurred rubbish. Okay, if you put down too much, it runs. Okay, if you use too little, doesn't do anything. So it's a little bit of a balancing thing to do it. And as you know, if you see my things on deckling and things, and I'm thinking when we had trouble with the F15 with silvering, it's literally that thing of like, I know, stick this on it. But as you say, it's just that thing of finding a correct balance. Okay, so next up we have Lee. Hi Phil, thanks for answering a question a few weeks back regarding the correct paint match for the GT40 Golf Oils colours. I did manage to contact hiroboy.com, and yes, they had the correct paints, the fantastic service, and a pleasure to deal with. My question for this week is, the Infinity CR Plus seems to have an air valve problem. The air seems to only be slightly getting through the front despite a complete clean out and O-ring replacement. It seems to improve its airflow after a few minutes, and sometimes starts to work fine with good flow But if it doesn't, use the airbrush for a few days. Sorry, if I don't use the airbrush for a few days, the same things happen. Do I need a new air valve unit? Or is it an easy fix that I've overlooked? To be honest, I've never had or heard of this problem before. A couple of little things you might want to take a look at is knocking everything flying. Okay. First thing you want to do is make sure you've got the correct needle and nozzle set. It sounds silly, but the amount of times over the years I've been doing this where people have had like a 0.4 nozzle with a 0.2 needle, hardly any air gets through. But you're saying it's intermittent, so I don't think it is that problem, but it's always something to be aware of. If you've got a thing where there's not much coming through, it can be the problem. The other thing as well, what you want to check, is when you dismantle your airbrush, I'll get this all apart, okay, just to make sure that there's a slice down the end. I know you're hardly going to see it, but if you look down the end here, you're going to notice there's a slice out of the side. That's where your air is coming in. It's coming up from the bottom here, and then it travels down the side. It's got nothing to do with the needle, okay? It gets into this end here, with this where you've got the hole in here. Then it's only got one place it can go, and that's out the front. If it can't do that, it then comes back up the needle, all right? But make sure that slice is clear. Okay, so what you want to do is plug it in, and you just want to feel everything's coming out, okay? You want to put literally your hand over the top, so when you put your end on, it can only come back up. Now, I'm not a believer in backflowing your airbrush, and you might notice, you'll never see me where you get people and they're saying about cover the end and blow it, and it, because it puts pressure down the other end, and that's what you don't want, okay? But you just want to make sure it's coming through. Now, your other thing you want to check, if we just whip this guy off, okay, if you're happy that that seems to be going all right, take the air stem off like this and check that you're actually, the needle is poking up, obviously the little nipple, but the air comes out the slice on the side. So if you pop your little thing in here, nothing should happen, but when you press the nipple on the top, you should get the air come through. Just mind your little seal doesn't fly off, all right? And that's the same thing. Feel to see how much air you've got coming through it, all right? So if that's fine, you know you're okay, all right? Then, this is where it becomes really difficult because it's a bit of a pain to take these off when they've been on as long as these, so I don't know which, oh no, came off right, okay. Then, your next one is, okay, under the back end of it, you'll notice there's a little brass plate, okay? And in there is a screwdriver. Okay, and here's my big screwdriver. What you can actually do is unscrew it all the way, and you'll notice you've got a spring in there and there'll be a little nipple. Don't lose the spring or that thing at all, okay? And that is literally the top, this guy here, okay? Now on here you'll find a little tiny rubber O-ring, okay? Now if you've got the seal set, it's part of there, make sure that that O-ring is okay, all right? Technically, and it's the thing that seems weird, because if you don't have this little seal, it's always going to be letting air through, because it's what prevents the air coming through, because it pushes up and away you go, all right? But generally that's it. Then what you want to do is try and get this thing back together, which is can be a thing. So pop that in, pop the spring in the bottom. Okay, it can be a bit of a handful popping this in, so just take your time with this. So I'm hoping this is all in now and doing that. Okay, so you should find now that the nipple is very springy. This is how you adjust the spring tension on the top on your trigger. Okay, if it's right down at the bottom, it makes it very sloppy, okay? And sometimes you have trouble when you get run on and stuff like that. If you screw this thing up, the tighter it goes up, the more tension is on that spring, okay, which makes it harder to push the needle down. It might be worth just giving it a couple of screws up and tightening this guy up. To be honest, I usually run all of mine about half and half, but it's how you actually adjust the spring tension. But if you ever got a thing and you're thinking, it's, you know, it's too sharp. For instance, perhaps you like there's no difference. You might be clever, you know, and literally just lack, you know, slacking off the air pressure for doing different things. Most of us just hold it down and away you go. But if you are one of these guys and you think it's all or nothing, undo the bottom, okay? But it might be worth doing it up a bit just to see how you get. So I'm just going to slacken mine off just a touch. Okay, down on there. And then you should be able to put this on the back. Stick the nozzle on the front. Needle in here. Okay, and that up. But because you're saying it's an intermittent type of fault, then try that. Okay, so there you go again. It's nice and sharp. Also, have you got a Mac valve? If you've got a Mac valve, make sure this guy isn't suddenly playing up. I have had one in the past that it was all or nothing. It had no bit in between. So when you turned it, it was on or off. It was literally as simple as that. And what it was, apparently it was playing up. Something inside had failed or whatever it was. So I changed it and never had a problem ever since. But as I say, so if you have running a Mac valve on here like this, then maybe try it without it. Take the Mac valve off and see how it performs without it, okay? But it should be nice and sharp and responsive. And, you know, this one here, I have it set about halfway. So you can probably hear the difference. Slackening right off, full off, halfway, and all the bits in between. But if you do it right the way up, you get just on or off. It's as simple as that. But the lower that is, the more range you get with the air pressure. Okay, a lot of people seem to think that, and I've heard a lot of people say this, this is the air pressure valve, that this is what this does. No, it's not. This is for the trigger. And if you have it right the way off and you have that screw right the way down, you've got loads of room on this trigger. Artists use it a lot. For us, especially acrylic painters, I probably would go half and half all the time. And it's fine, all right? But that's the thing with it, you know. But check it first. Make sure you haven't got something gone up there, dry paint, bit of kitchen towel. Could be your cleaning out, your airbrush and all the rest of it. If you're happy that you've got just air flowing through it and all the rest of it, you're fine. Check the nozzle. Could be something as simple as that. But generally, have a look in the Mac valve as well. Just be careful when you undo it, because if you lose that little spring, it's a nightmare. You have to get a replacement one in. They are available, but I've never lost one yet. But you wait. I'll probably lose one next week. Always the way. All right. So just be careful with that one. Okay, so Landon says, hi Phil, what is the difference between the benefits of using Mr. Color self-leveling thinners compared to using Tamiya X20A thinner? Can you use Mr. Color self-leveling thinners with Tamiya Model Air and or Steinel Res? When we did it in testing, yes, you can use it with everything. Self-leveling thinner is a lacquer thinner. Okay, now if you're using something like Tamiya paints, Guns paints, they are technically a synthetic lacquer, i.e. there's no water in it, all right? So because of that, they work really well with lacquer paints. Some of the best effects you can get is using self-leveling thinners. Now, as I said, from my personal point of view, I'm trying to avoid it and just trying to use the nicer things in life. And before everyone says, yes, I know, we know X20 isn't nice and everybody else isn't nice. If you want to be nice, I'll be using distilled water. I don't like distilled water. I never got on with it. It doesn't work for me. So I do what I think is the next best thing. Okay. So that's why I use X20A. But for years, I did use self-leveling thinner with Guns paints and Tamiya and, you know, other people's as well. One thing you don't want to put lacquer thinners in, though, is things like extra acrylics, because it'll turn to tar. I don't think you want to use it in model color, because I think it'll turn it to tar, okay, and various things like that. I'm sure there's guys out there who've done paint conversions of what works with what thinners, but generally the synthetic one, so when I say synthetic, the easiest way is just to look for, okay, if it says acrylic but it's got a flammable thing on it, you know full well it's a synthetic. Okay, so the chances are it's a nasty, all right, so that means it'll work with nasty products, so think about it like that way. Okay. Also, sometimes experimenting with micro sol will lighten up the paints around my decals where I've applied it. I also sometimes have issues with the carrier film not sticking down after using Microsol or X20A. The carrier film is really noticeable, like bad silvering. I cut and poke holes through the carrier film and nothing I'm applying to over the decal. A few coats of gloss, even expensive. Have you ever experienced this? Have you ever used Wolhern solvent decal solution? No to the last bit. We've all had decals though that are nasty. Airfix decals used to be really, really nasty, to the thick where they were just like, you know, the paper that's on the back of decals. It was more like that. It was horrible. It's that thing. Good quality decals are usually thinner and they adhere better. There's a couple of exceptions though. Tamiya decals always seem to be quite thick, but they seem to go down really, really nicely, and they give great coverage. You know, so from that point of view, it's usually the thicker decals don't like it. I'm a great believer in that not all decals are alike. For instance, I was looking at these ones earlier, just before we came on air, to be honest, and I don't want to lose my bit of photo etch down in here. Yeah, I was saying, some of them are like this. It's like, but I was looking at these. Now, these are done by Skyline Decals. And I'm just looking at them. And the way I look at a decal is, how noticeable is the carrier film on the sheet? And it's not on this. These are absolutely beautiful done. But they are very, very thin. Because when you run your hand over them, I can't feel particularly where they are. Obviously, you can feel it. But there's no real big, you know, giant steps with it. So to me, I'm thinking these decals should be pretty good. Now, as I said, I've used Skyline once in the past and they worked a treat for me and I had no problem. But I've used decals that have been a complete nightmare. When you compare them to this one, for instance, and you feel these feel really quite thick, okay? And I imagine that these walkway ones and that would give me, yeah, a little bit of headache and all the rest of it. But they're not as bad as I think perhaps you can find with some people out there, which will quite happily flog your decals, which are horrible. Okay, but as I said, Airfix used to be a nightmare for it. Revel decals used to be terrible. To be honest, everyone's sort of getting on with the bandwagon now and sort of bringing us along good decals. There isn't, but there is some older kits now which have very flat, very hard to get down decals. A couple of things you can obviously do to help that out. Gloss coating. You don't have to gloss the entire aircraft. If you're doing like a roundel, just gloss where you're actually going to place that decal. Okay, so you can put it down that way. The other thing as well you can do is the old future trick where you pre-brush the area with the future in the area, and then literally as that's all still wet, put the decal on top, push it down. Okay, and then it welds itself that way. It's a very old trick. Sometimes it works better than others, like all decaling thing, because not all decals are the same, okay? And that's what I'm trying to get at here. What works one doesn't work for another, yeah, so forth and so on. If I remember rightly, these decals, for instance, were right pain in the ass because the head at the back here didn't like going down whatsoever. But after it's been buried under like gallons of lacquer now, it looks very good and looks almost painted on. But that's literally because it's buried in there. They're very thick, and just with the whiskers and the way they were, it just didn't like going down too much at all. But there is no easy option time. You're getting this lightening around it. Chances are you've got too much setting solution, and it's just the, you know, the chemicals and the various bits and pieces that are in that, in the solvent that's actually gone down. And as everything else evaporates, it's leaving it behind. So don't put quite as much down. Lots of thin coats is better than one giant heavy coat. Okay, usually heavy coats is where I've had enough and I'm bored and I'll literally flood it. To be honest, the eagle's head on the tail on the Typhoon was a classic example. Had a few little problems with it. A lot of that was my own making. I was rushing it and all the rest of it. But it was a case of, right, okay. So I ended up letting it dry out completely because I was just getting too annoyed with it. Then I come back afterwards, sliced it to pieces all over this guy. And then we went over it with X20A quite liberally. And then we left it and just leave it. Let it dry for a couple of days, come in again. But I didn't keep coming in as soon as it was dry because obviously, you know, you're going to start melting paint. And if I remember rightly, I did because I actually scuffed it because I was going over it with a cotton bud. And I scoffed the paint because it was getting a little bit dry. But generally, with them all, you know, those decals, if I remember rightly, weren't that bad. But for some reason, there's a lot of carrier film around with the eagle head. And it just, you know, on black, everything shows. So it's just that thing. You need to just take your time and work your way through it. But in the past, we've been stoned. Because when we did that F-15C, those decals were horrible. They just didn't want to go down at all. So I ended up using extra thin glue on them. As I said, very much a last case with those. Don't do that just because you can't be bothered. Okay, so we are running rapidly out of time because I've got to edit all of this. Okay, so Simon says, strange of you to mention, but I have been having some problems It's strange you should mention this. Did I? Sorry. I'm pre-reading as I'm doing it. It's strange that you've mentioned this, but I'm having some problems with Mr. Hobby 136 Aquis, which is the white paint that you put that I posted up in the forum. I'm not sure what the problem is, but I have had have to coat several times to gain what I would call the correct coverage over the light grey primer, so I wasn't sure how it would work over black. This paint in particular appears to have a very low pigment count, making it almost translucent when applying. I have tried various thinning ratios and have applied it neat without satisfactory results. I'm wondering if there is a batch issue here, as it happened with the AK recently. Also, experienced a couple of problems with their lacquer colours when I was building my Hobby Boss A10 in Euro Camo. It thickened when thinning with Mr. Hobby self-leveling thinner. Would be interested to fill the team if had any issues. Right, okay. Well, if it's their lacquer and you're using the lacquer thinners, you should have no problem at all. It could be a batch problem. I must admit, I haven't had any problem with it, and I spray it, as I say. If you look at anything I spray white, you'll see it. The other thing as well, as you might know, I am in love with Tamiya XF2 when it comes to spraying white. I think it's still the best paint out there for spraying white. I can make anything look solid and good to go, even over black, within two coats, okay? Where I know a lot of people struggle with it. That's because I spray it almost neat for the first one. Second one's a 50-50 mix, and away you go. What you could do is use this as your base. So, for instance, if you were going to be using, and you do like that off-white colour, personally, you could always add a drop of grey into this, literally one drop into a colour cup, and it'll give you probably much of what you're looking there, okay, and do it that way, all right? But literally, spray this down first as your base, put down then a 50-50 mix for the second. You're seeing that that colour is a very wet one, this H316, which is this one here. Then, obviously, this will give you the top colour, but it would obviously won't have any trouble with the sort of, you know, it looking translucent because you've got the white below it from the Tamiya. Okay, and that will stop you having that problem. So that's probably the way I would do it. If I had a situation where I wanted a white and I wanted to go down the correct way of doing it, that's what I would do. But to be honest, I think if you have a look at when we did all my white colours, I just used Tamiya because I'm going to come along with the weathering and washes and things like that. It's going to go to an off-white anyway. So, you know, from my point of view, just thinking a step ahead, it will change in weathering and away we go. So that's why I don't really bother with this stuff. And why it's still empty, need to buy another one. But yeah, XF2... neat or very close to it, 90%, 50-50 with the second coat, job done. Overcoat it then with another shade of white just to give you the correct hue or whatever you're looking for. But it could be a bad batch, to be honest. Okay, last one. Unless I refresh. Have you considered offering a sort of optional premium membership fee that includes the Kit Buyers Club? So if it would be about £7 a month rather than the £3 that we charge at the moment, I think it would be a great way to get more people into the Kit Buyers Club, also improve the number and the value of subscriptions. You could also give forum benefits such as increased message sized box, maybe little incentive, premium title member. Now, okay, it's a little bit difficult how this is all working because, as some of you know, I don't actually own the sanders or the washes, the pigments, or the Kit Buyers Club. Actually, it's nothing to do with me. I've given that up so I can do this side of it. There's a team, they deal with that side of it now. There's a bit of a problem because, obviously, shipping internationally takes different insurances. You guys who've got model shops know all about this. And it's... at the end of the day, they're offering such good discounts, basically 30% off everything, sometimes even more, that there is no margin, so they don't make any money. So the 50 quid they charge you for being in the Kit Buyers Club is basically their admin fee for doing all the work for as much as you do. So they're hoping, technically, you're not going to use it For every, day of the week, because otherwise they're going to be working their ass to the grass for absolutely nothing. Okay, the whole point is that by having all you guys together, they can buy in bulk. And when they buy in bulk from the Far East, UK distributors, European distributors, whatever, it just gives you buying power. And that's what we're trying to do. And it's something I've wanted to do with the company for a long, long time. And I pushed them into this, to be honest, because I thought it's a great way. You might remember we had Flory Models had a store at one point, and we used to flog everything I did. So any paints I'd use, any, clamps or whatever, any tools, airbrushes even, we used to sell. Okay, but we closed that down around about 5-6 years ago, purely because the amount of work. It was a lot of work, okay? But now we don't have distributors, so we can keep the deals and the pricing even better because we're not paying for a middleman anywhere. So we can keep all the prices down and everything else like that. We can go out then to, manufacturers, direct, distributors, whatever, and say, well, look, we want to spend $5,000 with you on an order. What deal can you do? And it's simple as that. And then we come back, and then obviously you guys have all, then pay your money and do it like that. Yeah, they don't even charge a fee up front, the actual money up front for the kit. They go and get the kit, then charge you afterwards. So like when we had this stuff come in with the Shackletons and the bits and pieces, they were really getting scarce. All the distributors didn't have them. So I know it was a bit of a fight to try and scratch some rand here and all the rest of it. So I think we're on through 10 have gone out this week. And to be honest, the ones even you guys have come in for, those ones we had here on yesterday's vlog, they've been sold as well. So they've all gone now, apart from I've still got one. I must admit, I'm holding on to my one for the review, which I'll do later. And then obviously I'll build it some point in the year with any luck. But it is that thing, by getting everybody together, and you're all buying every week or once a month or whatever it is, but because of the volume of you, it enables them to go out and get better prices, better deals. You know, as you might know, obviously there's minimum orders and all things like that. So that's what they're trying to do. The trouble is, though, as soon as it goes out of the country, then obviously it's got to be sent. Shipping abroad is extremely expensive, as you might imagine. Kits, especially the bigger stuff, it's quite big, it's bulky and all the rest of it. They need to be insured and all those things. So it's by the time we've passed on all those discounts to you, it's going to get swallowed up with the shipping, insurance and everything else like that. So that is the problem. And that is the little stalling block that they're sort of playing with at the moment. And I've come up with a few ideas for them. They've come up with a few. Two of them I think are particularly bad, and I make no bones about it. But I would like it to be a situation where obviously it all comes under the Flory banner and everyone can help out. Premium members, I just think that's a bit gimmicky. I don't know. It's just that, we're all one big happy family here at the end of the day. So I don't really want to do premium members because it makes the guys who aren't premium members, everybody, we're not even members here. We're just one giant family, as you might know, and all the rest of it. Doing it the monthly way. The only trouble is, I'll be honest with you, we still have people join Flory Models to get the discount for buying the products. Because obviously, don't forget, the products, you're saving a lot of money. If you were just to be buying them individually, as members, you get a very good price for a full set of washes, full set of sanders, and all the rest of it. And then they join, pay the £3 to get the discount, because they know they're going to be saving £25. And they'll cancel their subscription the next day. So that is the trouble. You'll get somebody who'll join up, £7. He orders then £500 worth of kits and then disappears. And then he flogs them all on eBay or something. So, that is the problem they've got. It's not as simple as us just passing on a deal. Okay, and all the rest of it. I know it would be, and I would love us to have the store back again and, and all the rest of it and do it like that. But it's purely a thing of time, where that time is. And obviously at the end of the day, from the sales team, they need to make money to pay for their wages. They're paying their own wages. You guys aren't paying for them. So that is the problem, if you like, with it. So as I say, it's just one of those things. It's just a little bit of a stumbling block. Hopefully it'll sort itself out. But at the moment, it's just that thing. Also, shipping it abroad is just so expensive. They've done some test runs of it and it just isn't sort of viable just like that at the moment. So there we go. Thank you very much for joining me today. I hope we got through everybody's questions as you can. I'm still playing, to be honest, with the live stream. Some of you might know because I was messing around with it yesterday, and it is that thing, because it's a new thing and everything else like that. It's just a case of learning it, getting to use it. But we're using something called Xtreme now, which is it's about £7 a month. But what we should be able to do is obviously bring guests in, have a nice split screen, both of us on the screen at once, me and Steve, or me, whoever, me, the guys here, and Steve, all on one screen, so we don't have to cut back and forth. We also should be able to play videos in amongst it, show pictures. We've got better streaming off of the direct site, and all things like that. But I need to learn how to use all this stuff because I haven't used it before and all the rest of it. But hopefully it's something I'll be doing over the next few days. I'd love to have a bit of a test with you guys one evening. So if all of you are around, I'll drop it in the forum and we'll try and get you in. The other thing as well, you'll be able to talk and live post in it. That's the other thing as well. Instead of doing through the forum, you'll be able to talk direct on it. Which makes it a lot more interactive, as in there's no delay. So that way we're talking about it, it's exactly there at that point, and everything else like that. So there's the little things I'm trying to work out, but obviously doing this, the other bits and pieces, and learning that all at the same time, it's going to take a while until I sort myself out and everything else like that. So there we go, that's it for today. First part of the airline will be up with you tomorrow. And everything else like that. So that'll be part one, which will probably get you to around about that stage and everything else. I'm going to crack on with the Halifax and probably learn about XSplit and all the rest of it. And I'll catch you all tomorrow.